My name is Arturo Farrell, and I am the founder and artistic director of the Afroland Jazz Alliance and the Afroland Jazz Orchestra. And I want to welcome you again to La Plaza at the Digital Village for the second part of our incredible experience performing with Maestro Lechiere Lieches and the incredible Orchestra Rumpilez at in Philadelphia, Temple University, on Friday, July 31st, 2015. An incredible concert. I had the privilege of performing with Maestro Lechieres and the amazing Steve Bernstein, and performing on Lechieres' compositions and Steve's compositions and one of my pieces. And it was really, truly one of the most memorable nights of my musical life. Today, we're inviting you to return for part two of this evening. And one of the best things I can tell you about this evening, though, is that afterwards, after witnessing this incredible concert, you're welcome to hang out for after talk that takes place between myself, the Lechieres Lieche, the great saxophonist, composer, arranger Livio Almeida, our dear friend, wonderful Brazilian guitarist Richard Miller. And it's a really interesting conversation. If you have any interest at all in Afro-Brazilian, Afro-Latin, Afro-folkloric, the music of the diaspora, this is a conversation not to miss. We hope you stick around. Thank you for being here.
Without further ado, I'd like to introduce to you Lechieres Leche and Orquestra Rumpilez.
Thank you. We'll be right back. Thank you. Boa noite. Isso. Todo mundo entendeu. Being incredible, we are very happy to be here. Very generous city. Oh. Who is? This music, the composition was Das Arábias. I make for the Arabic influence in Bahia music. It's called Alafia. Next tune, I want to say a kind of summer from Bahia before play the next tune, okay? Diferente tipo de samba da Bahia. Vamos tocar primeiro samba duro. Ou this samba is inside the next composition, okay? Now I explain this. Okay? Pedir pra parar. The rhythm called Samba Duro. Now you play Samba Afro from Ileaê. Samba Afro. Now you play the Grosfata from Samba. The oldest samba rhythm. It's called Cabula or Cabila. Here's the guy. He's the man. Okay, now you play o samba nasceu na Bahia. Samba is born in Bahia. Thank you. professional, the musician. Here, the bass line from Rumbilés. Tuba, Fernando Rocha. Baritone saxophone, Vinícius Freitas. And bass, trombone, Adailson Rodrigues de Maruim. Trombone section, Hugo San, first trombone. Vanilson Lemos. Juraci Metzbentine. Now you play a dupe.
Thank you.
Soprano, saxofone, Ronnie Scott. Ronnie Scott. Manda, Roninho. Tenor saxo, alto saxo, flute. Léo Rocha. Alto saxo, flute. Paulinho Andrade. Alto sax, flute, piccolo, everything. André Becker. Now you play the last music. I want to thank all big from my hands. Now you play the last music. This is a composition from a big name from Brazilian music, Dorival Caymmi. He was here in the United States for many years. He played Noite de Temporal. Thank you, danke, obrigado, merci, até a próxima vez. Thank you.
Philadelphia Jazz Project and WRTI. Very happy to present to you, first time in a U.S. tour, Orquestra Rumpilés. Give it up.
I want to thank to Brazil, Bahia government. He make it possible to come together with Philadelphia Jazz Home. Bahia Tussa e governo da Bahia. Queria agradecer também. You play team from Dorival Caymmi, Baixa do Sapateiro, ok? You go home. Thank you. See you next time. Everybody stay on samba. You need samba now, samba dance. Yeah, nobody sees. Everybody. Up, ok?
Let me begin by telling you one of the most beautiful experiences of my life as a musician was meeting you, playing with your musicians, playing your music, and the privilege of hearing you teach and hearing you speak, and we still play your music, and that was it for me. That was one of the high points of my musical life.
Uma das experiências mais altas da vida musical dele foi conhecê-lo, tocar sua música, e eles ainda estão tocando a sua música, e então para ele é uma das experiências mais altas da vida, da carreira dele musical.
Eu posso dizer o mesmo, para nós foi uma experiência única ter a participação dele, e a minha participação com a orquestra dele, para mim, foi uma experiência de aprendizado muito grande, de saber a possibilidade de qual a linguagem que eu usaria para poder fazer com que os músicos da orquestra dele entendessem essas minúcias da música que é muito particular, que é dos ritmos daqui de Salvador. E eles tiveram um resultado muito positivo.
So he feels the same way, Arturo. And it was a deep learning experience for him to come and play with your orchestra and to discover how he can translate the details of Brazilian music to people who aren't familiar with the intricacies of the rhythms of Bahia, Brazil.
A lot of people have very simple notions of what the music of Bahia and what candomblé is and what Afro-Brazilian music is. Can you tell us in a few words for our listeners? You don't have to give us the secret, but help us understand more about the beautiful, beautiful music of your people.
Às vezes as pessoas têm uma ideia muito simplificada do que são os ritmos da Bahia, do candomblé. Então o maestro Arturo está perguntando se você pode dar a essência, talvez não tudo, mas para as pessoas entenderem o que é, quais são a música brasileira, a música da Bahia.
Olha, eu prefiro falar sobre música popular brasileira. Eu vou te dizer os trechos pequenos, porque vai ser grande. Eu prefiro falar sobre a música popular brasileira e as matrizes africanas na música popular brasileira. Eu estou falando aí da bossa nova, eu estou falando do choro, eu estou falando do frevo, eu falo do maracatu. Essas músicas todas têm o mesmo fundamento de rigor, de estrutura, de forma de organização, né, vamos dizer, de forma de organização e de transmissão. Então, o princípio para essa música popular brasileira, ela parte da música ancestral do qual a Bahia preservou bem. Essa é a primeira parte que eu queria falar.
So he would like to speak about Brazilian popular music and the African roots and patterns found in that, in the music of choro, of frevo, of bossa nova, and que eu deixei
por fora? Maracatu.
Maracatu. So that's the area that he's going to speak, and specifically Brazilian popular music and the African influences and patterns found in it.
Beautiful.
Also the organizational forms, he said.
Yes.
Isso, exato. Então, o que eu quis dizer é que essa organização, ela faz parte do patrimônio da música popular brasileira como um todo. A diferença é que a Bahia, tivemos a sorte das matrizes que gerou a música brasileira. Por exemplo, a matriz do piano de Tom Jobim, eu acredito que vem de um toque conhecido do candomblé, que foi oriundo do Recôncavo da Bahia, por exemplo. Faça esse link rápido, assim. Eu estou exagerando. A matriz que o piano do Tom Jobim, ela, a gente faz o histórico dela e vai dar no final do século XIX a um tipo de música que saiu do Recôncavo da Bahia para o Rio de Janeiro, por exemplo.
Yes, so he's talking about the structures of all of Brazilian music and how they are present in specifically the music of Bahia,
And the example he's giving is that the piano, the way Jobim played the piano can be traced to Bahia, to certain structures that, and because Bahia has preserved more than anywhere the African inheritance in music.
No, yeah, tracing back to the late 1800s.
1800s,
Isso. Porque no final do século XIX, teve uma leva grande de baianos que foi para o Rio, por causa que o Rio de Janeiro era o lugar das oportunidades por causa da família real. É importante colocar historicamente por que é que esses baianos foram para o Rio. Yeah. Eu não estou dizendo que só teve chegada de escravos na Bahia, não é isso. O primeiro lugar que chegou escravos é São Paulo, Rio de Janeiro chegou, Bahia. Eu estou falando especificamente do samba brasileiro. O samba brasileiro, nós hoje, pelos estudos, entendemos que vem de um grupo étnico nesse deslocamento do final do século XIX.
So at the end of the 19th century, there was a migration from Bahia to Rio because of the economic opportunities in Rio, and that is one of the elements that created samba, because bringing that influence from Bahia to Rio is what generated specifically samba.
O Rio já tocava outro tipo de samba, só para saber. Já tinha um samba que era mais ligado ao lundu, ao maxixe, que gerou um tipo de samba até esse período. Mas depois, com a chegada desse grupo de baianos, esse samba se transforma no samba nacional que ficou mundialmente conhecido. Essa figura de samba que a gente fala. Um exemplo do samba.
Rio already had a certain type of samba that was a mixture of lundu, which is a colonial dance.
Do jango, do jongo, também do jongo.
The jongo and the maxixe. And those were what consisted of samba in Rio. But when with this migration from Bahia to Rio, what developed was the samba that became the internationally known samba.
Right, so those were colonial dances. Those were Eurocentric dances, and then that migration introduced the more African element into. That was where the great experiment really began to take shape.
So ele está perguntando se essas danças como o lundu, o maxixe, se eram europeias e que
os ritmos, as danças eram é uma mistura dos ritmos africanos com as danças europeias. Para criar a música brasileira, teve a influência da polca, rabaneira, de ritmos europeus, das danças europeias, né? O scotch, várias danças europeias. Inclusive o choro, estruturalmente, se considera que é a mistura do lundu com a polca, que é europeia.
So he's saying that these dances that he cited are a mixture of European dances and African rhythms. And so specifically choro comes from blending polka with the lundu. And so that created, lundu is an African dance.
Isso é uma forma muito superficial, é mais complexo do que isso.
It's
é
much
muito
more
mais complexo.
Much more complex than that.
Of course.
Essa é uma forma simples de falar o que é muito mais complexo, porque o choro teve mais influência rítmicas de outras nações também. A gente agora, analisando o choro de Pixinguinha, por exemplo, eu tenho um trabalho agora, um estudo com um colega, e a gente percebeu que tem influência de toques de outras entidades de candomblé, inclusive dentro do choro.
So so it's much more complex than just saying polka and lundu.
Right.
And there are influences from other countries. So analyzing a tune by Pixinguinha, they realize there's some candomblé involved in it too. So it's a much more complex process.
I've been dying to ask Maestro a question for many years, because and I know that he's traveled all over South America and the Caribbean, and there's hundreds of variations, for instance, in the bomba rhythm in just Puerto Rico. Hundreds. Just in Puerto Rico, hundreds of variations. And I wonder if he would speak to the source of so much are the sources of all the rhythms of Central South America and the Caribbean directly traceable to their African birthplace? And how do you even begin to catalog or assess how many of those sources of nutrition there are?
Então, a pergunta dele é um exemplo da música de Porto Rico, que se chama Bomba, que tem centenas de variações. Então, uma pergunta que ele há muito tempo quer perguntar a você, Letieres, é se é possível traçar, Livre? Rastrear as origens dos ritmos e da música africana no Novo Mundo.
Essa é o que eu tenho feito, que eu tenho tentado buscar fazer nesses últimos 30 anos, porque existem os radicais, que são os DNAs, as menores porções rítmicas, que eles chamam timeline, aí, o timeline. Então, a partir dessa observação, você consegue, e ele se desloca, ele não está na mesma posição sempre, ele, às vezes, se desloca para outros lugares. É uma observação um pouco complexa, mas de tantos anos observando, você consegue entender exatamente que aquele timeline pertence a tal etnia, a tal grupo, e aqui nós temos uma vantagem na Bahia, porque as grandes universidades da Bahia são os terreiros de candomblé, que com toda a perseguição que existe até hoje, toda a perseguição que eu falo de intolerância religiosa que existe até hoje, eles se mantiveram uma cultura muito intacta. Então, aí são os lugares de grande observação. Você consegue ter as nações de candomblé em Salvador, as três maiores, talvez, que se reuniram no país, né, que se formaram, Queto, Jeje e de Angola. Você tem representações e você consegue pegar de um fonograma contemporâneo um toque, desconstruir ele até a menor porção, primeiro exercício é esse, e procurar um relativo. Na realidade, eu não pesquiso direto do candomblé, só para deixar claro. Eu pesquiso fonogramas. A minha observação é feita a partir de gravações que eu tenho de antigas e de várias épocas.
So he's saying this question that you asked has been the center of his research for the last 30 years, and it comes from him researching what's the DNA, what's the smallest unit, musical unit, and he has an advantage in Bahia, because in Bahia the candomblé, the African religions, have remained intact despite the religious persecution that it suffers even today. And so his research is mainly through recordings. So he doesn't go and study the candomblé directly, but he studies through recordings, finding the smallest units, and he's found that it may vary, it may change a bit.
People call in the United States a timeline.
Timeline is a term for...
You call in Brazil... No. But he say clave in Cuba, clave. Like clave.
In Cuba, it's clave, a timeline, or bell pattern. Yeah.
The closest.
Eu observo a clave das músicas brasileiras para ele entender melhor a clave de diversas músicas brasileiras.
Yeah, so he studies the clave, the timeline in Brazilian music.
The closest thing that I have ever experienced to that, of course, is the music of Yoruban worship in Cuba. And sometimes, and of course, different slaves brought different, you know, different people came from different parts of Africa to the New World. But specifically, some of the rhythms that I've heard that end up being clave and Afro-Cuban come from Ghana. Can you speak a little bit about some of the sources?
Yes.
That...
Então, um exemplo disso que ele estudou são os ritmos de Yoruba da Cuba. E então ele descobriu que muitos desses ritmos vêm do país Ghana. E então ele queria que vocês falasse um pouco sobre isso, da origem desses
ritmos. A música brasileira. Tá. A grande parte da música brasileira, ela não vem desses países, segundo os estudos, eu estou falando tudo de forma muito aproximada, não é uma coisa carimbada, tá? Isso está em construção. Mas a minha observação pessoal é que grande parte da música brasileira, da cultura brasileira, ela não vem desses países subsaarianos, que a gente vai colocar como Nigéria, Gana, hoje o Benin, o Senegal, esses países subsaarianos. Eu não acredito que a grande parte da música brasileira vinha daí. Primeiro fale isso aí para continuar.
So he does not believe that the greater part of Brazilian music comes from sub-Saharan Africa. Yeah, so Ghana and Benin and Nigeria and Senegal.
Eu acredito que a grande parte que fundou a música brasileira vem da África Meridional, que seria do que a gente chama cultura Bantu. Não é uma etnia, o Bantu é um grupo étnico-linguístico, Bantu. Mas a gente, os países que chegaram em massa, desde 1600 no país, os escravos que foram trazidos, os seres humanos escravizados, né? Eu gosto de falar assim, os seres humanos escravizados que foram trazidos para esse período de 1600 para cá, a maioria vieram dessa região. Então, é Angola, Congo, Moçambique, Zâmbia, esses países. Daí eu acredito que grande parte da nossa cultura vem da colaboração cultural desses povos.
So Brazil inherited the Bantu to
desde 1600.
From 1600 on, and he made a distinction. He doesn't call the slaves. He calls the human being the enslaved.
Right, the enslaved human beings. That's correct.
And so the great part of African influence in Brazil comes from the Bantu ethnic group. It's a linguistic distinction, the Bantu, and mm-hmm. And so countries like Angola, Mozambique, and quais são os outros países?
Congo.
Yeah. And
Zâmbia. São os três maiores.
Yeah. The three largest.
Zâmbia. Agora eu posso falar algumas manifestações brasileiras que vêm desse grupo?
Claro. He wants to know if he can talk about some of the Brazilian manifestations that come from these groups.
I would love it if he would.
Primeira, o samba. O samba.
The first samba. One is samba.
Yeah. Okay.
Capoeira. Capoeira.
Capoeira, which is
maracatu.
Maracatu.
Samba de roda, tudo, todas essas manifestações que são descendentes, que são subgêneros do samba, vamos dizer assim, são dessa região. São várias.
So all these rhythms come from that region of Africa.
Can is there go ahead. No, Lieteris, please. Master.
Não, eu ia falar que a grande estrutura da música brasileira vem daí. Agora, existe sim na música brasileira influência subsaariana também, dos candomblés de Yorubá. Aqui no Brasil, Yorubá, a gente vai chamar o candomblé de Queto Nagô. Então nós temos também essa influência na música brasileira, mas é muito menor.
So Brazil,
assim como temos
Brazil does have the sub-Saharan influence from Senegal and those countries.
Nigéria.
Nigeria. And
Nigeria.
And so, but it's much smaller than the influence from the Bantu tribes. And
assim como também do povo do Benin, que antes era o reino de Dalmé, que virou Benin, também influencia de alguma forma de sutil.
And so,
eu estou falando a música popular, falando a música da rua.
Yeah, so he's talking about Brazilian popular music, and so even a country like Benin that was before called the kingdom of Dalmé, né?
Mas reino de Dalmé. A grande música de rua do Brasil, o samba reggae, as agremiações de rua, escola de samba, são de influência mais dessa cultura que chama uma cultura Bantu.
Yeah, so the greater part of the influences comes from the Bantu culture.
Aí chega a Orquestra Rumpilés. Agora chega a Orquestra Rumpilés.
And that's where the Orquestra Rumpilés comes from.
And I've always wanted to ask also, is there a blending between the music of the enslaved, the indigenous? Does that ever happen? Is there like indigenous peoples of Brazil? Is there an influence that has happened? No,
a música brasileira teve muito pouca influência indígena.
Uh-huh.
Muito pouca, por causa da primeiro da condição social, que os índios não se deixavam escravizar, os índios, e eles tiveram que buscar escravos na África. Então, o negro estava mais próximo dos centros urbanos, onde houve as primeiras configurações estruturais da música brasileira.
So, Brazil has had very little indigenous influence in its music, mainly because the natives of Brazil did not allow themselves to be enslaved, and they avoided the urban centers, and so that's one of the reasons that the African humans were enslaved and brought to Brazil, and they were much closer to the urban centers, and so the African rhythm is very prominent. The indigenous influence in Brazilian music is almost non-existent.
Mas temos influência, sim. Temos influência indígena.
But we do have...
Mas não é na potência que foi a música negra. Mas isso eu estou falando das Américas inteiras. Da Argentina, do tango, ao jazz norte-americano, ao blues, até o tango da Argentina.
This is true all over the Americas, that the African rhythm had a much more of an impact than indigenous music.
Right, and that indigenous music is very, very different and very, very strong, but never a blending. I wanted to say that this is a very special day, not only because I get to spend time with the maestro, but also one of my favorite human beings and one of my favorite musicians on the planet is sitting here with us. Great composer, great arranger, incredible saxophonist, flautist, Livio Almeida. And so I wonder if, Livio, you want to get in here and ask the maestro any questions, or you want to talk about the experience you had when we played together with Maestro Lietz, and anything that you want to interject would be welcome. By the way, I just want to say I love you, man, and we miss you so much, and I'm so happy to see you today.
Arturo, thank you so much for your kind words, man. I miss you so much, too. I really wish to see you again and play with you sooner than later when this whole thing, gets better.
Well, I have an invitation from Maestro to go visit, okay? So
beautiful. We got to organize then, like you go to the whole country.
You got
to
come to Brasilia. Get organized. Yeah, yeah.
Well, first, know that the experience of the Cuban and Brazil, the music from the Americas concert that we did a few years ago, I think was amazing, was beautiful. The blending of seeing what's you represent as a composer in for the music you do in for the whole America, and together with Letieres representing Brazil, I couldn't see a better combination first, because you guys really, it's like you're twin spirits almost. And I think that's why I feel so good, and I make both of you great friends, is because of that. We have a good match, as per se, but this discussion of the importance of African culture in the music of the whole Americas, of the New World, is so important and so necessary, especially nowadays with everything that you see happening. Both of you guys are so important, and I really admire, and I feel that it's a privilege for me to participate and be close to both of you.
Thank you, Livio. And I remember those concerts, and I remember the concerts at in Philadelphia with Steve Bernstein, and I remember the music of the Americas, and I wonder if any anything sticks out, any crazy stories, any... I remember, can I tell you, Maestro Leotiades, what I remember? I remember being backstage with you and gathering at a prayer circle.
Yeah.
And
I remember.
And I think you were praying the Our Father. I'm not sure. But I felt like so spiritually connected to you guys that all of a sudden I understood Portuguese.
Deu para entender, Leotiades?
And then having Livio with us in New York at the Symphony Space concert and playing your music, Livio, as I recall, we played some of your music. What
it was beautiful. What,
an honor to have that, man.
Yeah.
Beautiful stuff.
Have you and Luciano's been friends for a while, or have you?
Well, since that time we speak, of course he's in Salvador, I'm in Brasilia.
Right.
But we keep in touch, you know, I've been following his research a little more closely now, because since I've been in Brazil. He's gonna be, actually, I'm organizing a little saxophone thing here in Brazil that is gonna be a part tomorrow, I can extend the invitation.
I'm there. I go there.
That's invited. Yeah, it's funny because that was also, to me, what was also profound about meeting Maestro Leotiades was seeing him teach. And it affirms what I believe, that when you're a musician, whatever you do, you're a teacher. And so if you're going to be giving lessons, you should know what you're talking about. But I remember the beautiful lecture you gave about the specific places that this music comes from. And you're so knowledgeable, and you're such a scholar. And I wonder if you could talk about, is there a separation between the musician and the scholar, the teacher, or is that part of the magic, part of the...
A pergunta é se existe uma separação entre dentro de você, o músico, o educador e o pesquisador.
Eu vejo música uma coisa só. Mas tem uma coisa, quando eu estou pensando na pesquisa, eu acho que eu acesso processos que, quando eu estou criando ou quando eu estou tocando, é mais confortável, vamos dizer assim. Não é que é mais tenso, mas é assim, eu tenho poucas respostas. Por exemplo, eu não consigo, não é fácil entender ou ensinar ou pensar música brasileira, que é baseada na matriz africana, usando ferramenta de música europeia, por exemplo.
For him, it's all facets are the same, and when he studies, when he's a researcher studying, sometimes to translate that the African patterns, there's some difficulty in educating that. Me ajuda, Liv.
Usando as ferramentas da cultura europeia. Os toys. Quer dizer, eu estou usando a lente de uma cultura para explicar outra.
So the difficulty arises when he's translating the African patterns using European instruments. And so it's like looking at one culture with European glasses, looking at the African patterns. And so,
Por que isso, professor? Porque aonde eu leciono, onde eu dou aula, essas escolas mais antigas, elas já são todas formatadas em um pensamento de musical, somente na questão de ritmo, num pensamento europeu, eurocêntrico.
So, and the difficulty is that where he teaches, the structure is Eurocentric, and so, yeah.
What I was going to say is we're going through a crisis. I'm a professor at UCLA, and we're going through a big crisis right now because of the political and racial truths that are being discovered about America, we're discovering that the Eurocentric canon has is inaccurate. That in order to be really equipped as a human being and as an artist, you have to understand Bach and Brazil. You have to understand gamelan music and John Coltrane. And so we're looking at a crisis in theory in our world, because I say that we're not teaching students theory unless we teach them as much of the global way of organizing rhythms and sounds. There's so many ways to organize music throughout the planet, and they're all valid, they're all valuable. And so we're going through a big crisis trying to get away from Eurocentric, no parallel fits, the serial tone road, all that stuff. It's very important, but much more important to have a balance of global organization for music. And I wonder if they're going through anything like that.
Mas é isso que eu quero dizer. Eu tô falando isso.
So he's saying the same thing. Yeah.
É, eu não tô, não acho que deva abrir mão da cultura europeia. Não é isso que eu falei. O que eu acho é que não tem um equilíbrio. Por exemplo, eu acho que não é possível a escrita musical. Vê se ele concorda comigo. Vou perguntar para ele. Ele concorda que a escrita musical não é suficiente para poder representar os micro-ritmos? Pergunte a ele isso.
So he's saying that he's going through a similar experience, and it's not that he wants to do away with European music.
Not at all.
There's an unbalance. And his question to you is that in writing, in the musical notation, often the intricacies and nuances of the rhythms are lost, and he
micro rhythms
are often lost in the musical notation.
I have a theory. The theory is that you can write out Afro-based rhythms and you can read them, but it's not the same thing as respecting them, and it's not the same thing as growing up listening and loving music from that part of the world. So because we do it all the time, we have to write music for people who don't know this music to play. But nothing, one eighth note in somebody else's hands can sound different than in a European musician's hands.
A minha sugestão é usar as duas culturas em equilíbrio, como fez o jazz. O jazz escreve da forma europeia, mas toca em swing, timba com timba, mas escreve ta, entende? O jazz. Eu fazer o mesmo com a música brasileira, afro-cubana. É ensinar os músicos a interpretar em clave, mas não precisa forçar a escrita com muito sinal. Então, eu acho que tem que usar oralidade em comum acordo com a tradição da música europeia. Usar as duas culturas em equilíbrio. Pronto.
So he's saying that jazz does this. It expresses both cultures on a more even level. But what's important is to have the written experience of playing music equal to the oral tradition, because it's burdens the written music to try to add all the details, all the nuances, and so better to teach orally, with the oral tradition, the feel for a swing eighth note as opposed to what it looks like on paper, as opposed to trying to notate what the swing is.
Isso já ser matéria dentro da escola. Os professores serem preparados a usar as duas culturas, da oralidade em comum acordo com a escrita tradicional. Porque a escrita é só uma ferramenta, ela não é o fim. A escrita, a notação, ela é uma ferramenta, ela não é o fim. Então, precisamos preparar o músico no corpo dele, no corpo. E é isso que eu faço com o método que eu tenho aqui no livro que eu faço, da minha escola. Eu preparo primeiro sem instrumento. Eu treino o músico ritmicamente, que é a matéria mais difícil. Olha bem, se eu quiser coisa de harmonia, tem 400 livros de harmonia. Mas quando vai tratar de ritmo, tem que ser no corpo, não tem jeito.
So he's saying that what's important is to train the teachers and train them equally in the notation and the oral tradition, because notation is not the end product, it's a tool. And so what he does is he trains musicians in their bodies first, without notation, and that's his contribution, is a rhythmic training in the body, in the oral tradition, that precedes the notation. And
can I jump here for a second?
Yeah, please, always jump in, Livio. Yeah.
I would like to propose, I think it would be fascinating to hear Arturo and Lecieri talk about this, because I heard Lecieri talk a couple of times about a thought he has that I found fascinating, that a lot of people talk about syncopation in this kind of music, in Brazilian music or Latin music, no, or any other music from African diaspora. But he discusses that actually this is not exactly syncopation. If you think inside of the matrix rhythm, actually it's all downbeats.
Acentos naturais ou acentos culturais. Culturais.
Cultural accent. So, would be great, Lecieri, estou falando, é que eu ouvi você falar já umas duas vezes recentemente sobre essa questão.
Não tem, não existe sim. Fala para ele, não tem síncope na música brasileira. Eu não vejo síncope. Esses lugares que são acentos naturais da nossa cultura. Só é síncope se eu comparar com a cultura europeia. Se o meu parâmetro for o europeu. Pode falar isso, Lívia.
So, eu vou só colocar a definição do que é síncopa, né? So, he's saying the syncopated rhythms are deviations from the normal. And so he's saying that in Brazilian music there are not syncopations, because it's within the cultural accent of the music, and so it's not a departure from the natural accent, so it's not syncopated.
I have a theory that I've been working with for many, many years, and that is that it has to do with the way with the way we hear, the way we're trained. And in European, in Eurocentric training, we're taught to find the center of the pulse, to find that beat. And in my tradition, in Afro-Cuban tradition, we don't find a pulse or a beat. We find a phrase, a much larger entity. And so if you hear rhythmic activity in a larger setting, then it is all downbeats, because you're hearing everything. You're not assigning a pulse. You're not terrorizing the groove by containing it to a steady, even pulse. And that's what I, and so I think people who come from this music hear a very large beat. And so they don't hear, syncopation is the most natural thing in the world, because it is the music. It is the it is in this very large entity. And that's why, you know, that is what you can't write down. You can't write down the infinite. It's like trying to capture the infinite. It's like trying to imprison life and beauty and love. You can't do it.
Arturo, it's so interesting you talk right like that to me. I recently interviewed Joe Lovano.
Mm-hmm.
And he said something basically the same. I asked him, your playing is so much, has so much freedom and expression, yet it's so in the groove. And he said, I think on the big beat, I think two measures, four measures.
Well, Joe Lovano, in his relationship with time is huge. He'll take a phrase and he'll bend it and shape it, and it'll be this big, massive thing that all the, I want to ask one more thing, and I know that Lucero, we're so grateful for your time. I mean, I could sit here for hours just listening to you teach us. But before we do that, I want to also thank Richard Miller, who is an unbelievable guitarist. He's a special friend to the Afro-Latin Jazz Lines, and he was our director of education, and he has been a part of Music on the Inside and helping people. And as long as I've known Richard, he's someone whose heart is very big, and he's interested in being a part of help and community and love. So thank you, Richard, for this. This is extraordinary.
You're welcome. It's an honor for me.
So I was taught that one of the reasons Brazilian music and Cuban music are so beautiful and big and fat and wondrous is because the colonial forces did not control the enslaved people's worship and their celebration. They didn't take away their drums. They didn't take away their rites and their rituals. I wonder if you could comment to that.
Entendeu, Lecheres?
Não, prestou atenção.
Então, ele quer que você comente sobre a música cubana e a música brasileira, por elas serem tão importantes e tão grandes e tão com tanta influência, e ele acha que é porque os colonizadores não conteram, não controlaram tanto, não reprimiram tanto a cultura africana, não tiraram os tambores.
Em parte, isso é verdade. Historicamente, pelo que a gente estuda, a repressão nos Estados Unidos foi muito inglesa, da colonização inglesa, foi muito mais rigorosa. O único lugar onde foram mais flexíveis é na parte francesa, New Orleans, lá, Mississippi, onde o tambor crioulo conseguiu se manter até formar o drum set. A gente sabe que tinham mais tambores, mas que foi muito, a repressão foi mais massiva.
Tá, peraí.
Em parte.
Peraí, deixa eu traduzir essa parte. So he's saying that this is partly true. Historically, the English colonization was much more rigid and repressive, and so in the United States, the only areas were of areas of French control, like Louisiana, where the drum set was developed, but in general, the English repression was much more severe than the rest.
Agora, isso não é verdade que não teve a repressão no tambor no Brasil. No Brasil tinham leis que não permitiam que se tocasse o tambor na rua, nem o funcionamento de candomblé.
So it's true also that there has been repression in Brazil. And there are actual laws prohibiting playing drums on the street or even in candomblé.
A lei que tira a perseguição a candomblé, ela só foi extinguida em 1976. É recente.
The law that that prohibited playing drums on the
candomblé,
street.
Candomblé. A perseguição.
The persecution.
Aonde a percussão está lá dentro, né? Claro.
So the persecution of playing drums in candomblé was only removed as a law in Brazil in 1976.
And that's interesting, because that's when they made it a law.
Então, há uma história muito engraçada no Rio de Janeiro. Uma história muito engraçada de um pandeirista chamado Heitor dos Prazeres, que no pandeiro dele, dentro do pandeiro, ele tinha um salvo-conduto de um deputado, de um político, que dizia que ele era uma pessoa de bem e ele podia andar com o pandeiro. Tinha
so
essa história que é engraçada.
One of the early pandeiro players in Brazil, written on the backside of his pandeiro was a letter from one of the government officials saying that he could carry his pandeiro because he was a respectful person.
Isso é o final do século XIX, virada do século XX.
The end of the 19th century and into the 20th century.
Então eu vou te contar. Eu acho que o motivo é outro. Para mim, o motivo mais forte dessas duas culturas terem uma música um pouco mais dominante, eu vejo um outro motivo.
O motivo
que eu vejo é os grupos étnicos que formaram esses dois países, são muito semelhantes. Se você estudar um pouco mais, Você vai ver que os grupos que vieram subsaariano, eles vão para... No Brasil, inclusive, eles só vêm para a Bahia. Tem alguns grupos que só vieram para a Bahia. De Orubá, de Benin, do Pom, dessa cultura. E foram para Cuba. Então, por isso que Cuba tem o Daumentanos, tem a cultura Daumé, o Abacuá cubano, fora a Santeria. São semelhantes, tem semelhança no Brasil com algumas correntes étnicas. Então, eu acho que tem a ver com o que foi a última leva de escravos. Seria o final da vamos dizer, a última, segunda metade do século XIX, foi quando foram as últimas levas. E esses, a leva que foi para Cuba é semelhante à leva que veio para a Bahia.
So he's saying part of...
Etnicamente falando, de grupos étnicos.
So he's speaking ethnically, the enslaved humans who went to Cuba had a shared ethnicity with the ones that went to Bahia in Brazil. And
of course,
it was especially in the last waves of slave trade in the 19th century, the ethnic groups that went to Cuba also went to Brazil. So the part of the similarity in the two cultures comes from
Abacuá. E esses grupos vinham de países subsaarianos, da região que eu falo de Gana, de Nigéria e do atual Benin.
Yeah, so and these groups came from the sub-Saharan Africa, Nigeria and the Ghana and Benin.
I grew up in New York City. I came from Mexico, but I grew up in most of my life I remember drum circles in every park, in every corner of every street. And in the 1980s, we had a very oppressive, tyrannical mayor that started outlawing drum circles and arresting drummers and taking away their drums. And I just want to say that at this moment in history, it seems like we're repeating a terrible, terrible time in human history. But I'm a person of great faith and great hope and great optimism. And Master Lichieres, Richard, Livio, we will live to see the two orchestras and to compose and to laugh and eat together and have fun and hug one another and enjoy the life that was meant for us to be a part of. And this is indeed a great and tremendous honor, Lichieres, tremendous honor. We will see that day. We will join together and make a lot of music, man. We'll add our healing
to
the world.
I hope.
I'm hoping too. Me too.
I hope.
Me too.
Me too.
Thank you. Thank you, Master.
Thank you a lot. Thank you,
Livio. Thank you, Richard.
Thank you.
Be well, sir.